Yeah, you're not putting it away, you just okay. Okay, hello everybody. Oh, it's on. Missed you guys yesterday. Yeah, sure. Parshas Truma, which follows Parshas Mishpatim, and we will discuss certain central point that is reflected in Truma that it connects to something very important in Parshas Mishpatim. You learned that Hashem said to Moshe that he should tell the Yidden that they should build a house for Hashem. V'yikhuli truma, they should separate, take from their possessions, separate from in my name, and then they would make for me a mishkan. V'shachanti b'seicha. V'shachanti mikdosh, actually it says. V'shachanti mikdosh, you make me a holy house. V'shachanti b'seichom, and I will dwell within them. What does this mean, that Hashem will dwell within them? We each, we know ourselves. And we have a hard time thinking of ourselves as a house for Hashem. We have a hard time, we have a struggle to understand the whole thing. What is this all about? And simply put, even though we are assured that we have a nefesh olikis, a godly soul, but we are very much aware that we have an animal soul. That one we are very close to. And we have the yetzer hara. And yet, Hashem says, all they have to do is donate some gold, silver, build a house the way Hashem has described it, and then I will dwell amongst them, as we say, amongst them, I will dwell within them. As we explained, I'm sure you heard the special expression in the Pasuk, it says, they will build for me a mikdosh v'shachanti b'soichom. And the Rebbe says, let's go back to the Alter Rebbe, b'soichom, it doesn't say b'soichoi, I will dwell within the house that they will build, but I will dwell within them. That means that by building this house, every yid facilitates, everybody knows what facilitates means, makes it possible for Hashem to dwell within him. So we know that this is true because the Torah says so. But I want to discuss a and go a little bit into the inside of this, so that we personally understand that this is really something that we can relate to, that this is something that makes sense to us, and we know how to capture this and how to relate to it. We spoke in the past, pointing out that the Jewish people, as a people, were created, not only that they are different because they come from a different ancestry, from Avraham, Yitzhak, and Yankiv and all that, but the way they came out to be a nation was totally different than any other nation in the world. The Jewish people did not grow up into a nation in the, what's called the natural way. The natural way is, say for example, Chom had a son, Canaan. Chom had a son, Mitzrayim. Mitzrayim went and he settled in that land that's called Mitzrayim. And his offspring and all the people that came from him all settled around that area. And that became a nation, Mitzrayim. Canaan went and settled in another land. And his offspring became a nation, Canaan. So this was, so to speak, a natural way that a nation develops, even in our own days. The United States, America, there is no such thing as an American person except for the Indians, but generally speaking, the European. Everyone in America is someone who came from some other land. But after so many years living together, geographically together, and forming a certain habits and certain principles, there is what's called an American person. And that becomes like a nation. The Jewish people, as a people, were not created that natural way. When Yankiv came to Mitzrayim, there was some kind of a beginning of a nation. There were 70 people. Not a very big nation, but 70 people, okay. So if Yankiv had continued to live in Eretz Yisrael, in his land, and his people would develop around him, then he would say, okay, this nation developed in a natural way. But that's not what happened. They came to Mitzrayim. And in Mitzrayim, they were subjugated, they were subdued, they became slaves. And during this time, they completely lost every last connection to what they stood for. They forgot completely of their personal identity, who they are, what they are. And from that abyss, from that low state, Hashem created a nation. The expression over there is, when it says that Hashem took Eden out of Mitzrayim, it says, Lokachas loy goy mikerev goy, that he extricated, he pulled out a nation from within another nation. He picked out certain people. He says, okay, you're mine, you're mine, you're mine. He picked them out and says, okay, this is my nation. And each one of these who were picked out were aware that they are given an identity, a new passport, so to speak, a new identity. by the miraculous redemption that Hashem took him out. There was nothing natural about it. Then, as we know, when it came to Har Sinai, and Hashem gave us the Torah, we spoke about it previously, that in the Maseres Adibrois, in the Ten Commandments, the first commandment, Maseres Adibrois, it says, Onoichi Hashem Elokecha, I am your God, Asher Yitzisicho Me'eretz Mitzrayim, that drew you out from the land Mitzrayim. And there's an emphasis, there's a diyuk, there's a point made, that it does not say, I'm your God who created the world. Created Shemayim Ba'aretz. If Hashem wanted to introduce himself and say, you know who I am? He should have said, I'm the one who created Shemayim Ba'aretz. That's a kind of a bigger introduction. That's not what he said. He said, Onoichi Hashem Alekecho Hashem Yitzisicho Me'eretz Mitzrayim. I took you out of the land of Mitzrayim. What's the point in there? The point in there is that Hashem did not say this, did not intend here to point out to Yidden how great he is and how powerful he is and that they better listen to him. That's not what it's about. But Hashem came to tell the Yidden, he said, you and I have a special relationship. I am the one who have given to you an identity. I'm the one who defined who you are. Before Matan Torah, before Hashem came down Har Sinai and spoke, as we spoke previously, the Yidden said to Moshe, they said, Koel Asher Dibar Hashem Naaseh V'Nishma, and everything Hashem said, we will do and we will listen. The first thing that Hashem said, and that Yidden have to accept, Nas, that they have to do, what is the very first thing? The first thing is that they should accept that Hashem made them into a nation. You ask, you know, who am I? What am I? Where do I come to all of these things? No way, you don't come to it by yourself. But accept one thing. Hashem had declared, had said, you are my nation. This is what Anoich Hashem Elokecha Asher Yitzisicho Me'eretz Mitzrayim means. This recognition is primary in the Jewish in Jewish mind. We can ask ourselves all kinds of negative questions. Am I that smart? Am I that good? Am I that capable? What have I accomplished? What have I accomplished? What can I do? What will I ever do? And the answer to all of these negative thoughts is that regardless of who I am, I have accepted from Hashem the command that I am his nation. And I accept this. We speak all the time. We'll come back to Truma. Speak all the time. You know, life is an ongoing thing. Every day, a person is challenged. Every day, one has to have the encouragement, the inspiration to get up and do what he has to do. And we mentioned so many times that the Chachomim have established that the first thing we do when we wake up in the morning is we say Moedei Ani. And what is this Moedei Ani? This Moedei Ani is a reminder to ourselves. It's a reminder to ourselves. Oh, I'm tired. I don't feel like getting up. I don't feel like doing. Why should I do? What's going to be? It's a reminder to ourselves, look, you don't have to do anything. Just accept the fact that Hashem has returned the neshama to you. And once you accept and recognize this obvious and simple principle, then that itself will give you the strength and propel you into fulfilling your duties and fulfilling your obligations. In other words, Na'aseh v'nishma. I want to come bring a little bit of a different color to this. Nishma means we will understand. We will become scholars. We will know. We will prove ourselves. Eden said, yes, whoever, whatever we become, and however smart we are, and whatever we'll get to know, Nishma, what we really pride ourselves on, and what really is the basis of all that, what gives us the strength, and the encouragement, and the impetus, and the inspiration to do all that is the Na'aseh. Na'aseh means we recognize, we accept Hashem's declaration that we are His nation. This is our primary pride. This is who we are. Whatever we accomplish after that, we start learning, and we become scholars, or we don't become scholars. That's completely secondary in terms of who we are. We will do this as that nation that Hashem chose. But this is not what defines who we are. What defines who we are is Hashem's own declaration. It's by Him. He telling us who we are. One of the central teachings, we have also discussed this as I recall here, of the Baal Shem Tov. You are in the Chassidish Yeshiva, and Chassidus, you know, is all based on the teaching of the Baal Shem Tov. And what was the central thing of the Baal Shem Tov? Amongst other many things, but what was the center? The central teaching of the Baal Shem Tov is that the greatest treasure in a Jewish person is not his scholarship and not his talents and not any of the other qualities. It is his Jewish soul. And that, Baal Shem Tov said, everyone has. And what's special about the Jewish soul? What's special about the Jewish soul is that Hashem chose it. Hashem loves it. Hashem chose it, and Hashem declared this nation as His nation. And that relationship between the Jewish, between the Yid and Hashem, cannot possibly be broken, because Hashem Himself created it. Hashem is the one who created this link, this connection. It cannot be broken. And this is what the Torah says in this parsha. After last week's parsha, after Eila HaMishpot, after that even said Naseh V'Nishma, that Hashem says they should separate, they should take from their possessions, give it, declare it as in Hashem's name, that they are declaring it, giving it to Hashem, and they should build for me a house. And when they build this house, I will come, I will dwell in this house. Again, this is not something that anybody can imagine, that he will build a house and Hashem will dwell in the house. How then does it happen? It happens by Hashem's choice. Hashem is the one who builds the house. Hashem is the one who chooses and declares, I will be in this house. But Hashem wants that the Yid, by taking his gold and his silver and donating to this house, the Yid is in effect accepting Hashem's relationship. Hashem wants to be related to me. Here I am accepting it. That's all it is. He doesn't have to do anything. He doesn't have to create anything. He has to remember who he is and by the fact that Hashem declared who he is. And he accepts it. How did he show he accepts it? He goes and he builds a house the way Hashem said. This process, he says, we also limited Shechan to Besaychom. This process where we recognize first and foremost that all the koiches and all the abilities that we have in terms of our relationship to Hashem actually begins by Hashem himself. He's the one who started it. He's the one who initiates it. This extends itself in every aspect of our lives. When we do, we put on tefillin. Yeah, he did the rap. Yeah, what was the tefillin? Hashem said that this is tefillin, and I want you to put it on your hand in order that you would show that you recognize that I have made a covenant with you. That's all. But the covenant was made by Hashem. We are there only to accept that declaration. This approach, which is the primary approach in Torah, this makes it possible for us to understand and to understand who we are and to answer, so to speak, the question, how do I come to do a mitzvah? What do I understand about a mitzvah? What do I understand about God? It's all imaginary. I don't want to live, I mean, how can a person, you know, I'm an intelligent person, I can't live in an imaginary world. I see the physical world. Yes, I understand, and I have logical explanations and so forth, but we're not talking about logic, we're talking about living it. on a daily basis. How do we get to live with this and to actually to relate to it personally? We relate to it personally by recognizing just exactly what Yidden experienced and recognized when they came out of Mitzrayim. We can recognize and experience here, each one of us, on a daily basis. Just as when Yidden came out of Mitzrayim, they were a non-entity. You know what non-entity means? There was nothing there to be recognized. And they were completely defined and identified by the Melech and by Hashem, but He took them out. Every one of us who comes back to himself and asks the question, who am I? And why do I come to do all of these things? How do I understand about it? Which means he says, oh, I'm a nothing. He says, yes, you're absolutely right. I'm a nothing. And therefore, who am I after that I'm not nothing? I am only that which Hashem makes who I am. Since I myself am a nothing. So what am I then? I am what Hashem declares that I am.
Hashem declares the guy to be nothing?
No, Hashem declares that he is his person. That he gives me mitzvahs. I'm sure everybody understands that Hashem doesn't declare that we are nothing.
We
see ourselves as nothing. We see ourselves that we cannot imagine what this is all about. I'm so important. I have mitzvahs and I build a world. Where? How do I come to do this? And you say, yes, you're absolutely right. And you know, not only you, but you pick any one of the 5 billion people in the world and they all in the same category. So therefore, what am I? I am that which Hashem declared that I am. That's the approach. This is the approach with which a Yid faces his daily life and faces his life in general. We always encourage one another, encourage ourselves and encourage another. Don't worry, Hashem will help. And then deep down in my own mind, I think, I don't mean me, I mean collectively, you know, why would Hashem help me? What am I? Why would you think of me? This is a question that flutters through everyone's mind. This is a question that throws the biggest doubts and destroys the inspiration of every person. And the answer lies right here. That the reason that Hashem, they say Hashem, I'm confident that Hashem will take care, and Hashem will lead, and Hashem will help, and Hashem will lead in the right direction. And if I do the right thing, it will be successful and all that. The confidence comes precisely from the fact that Hashem is the one who declared my importance. Not for myself. Where did he declare his importance? That goes right through from the time of Yetzias Mitzrayim to Anoich Hashem Elokecha Asher Yitzicha Me'eretz Mitzrayim. Notice that Anoich Hashem Elokecha in Aseret HaDibris is said in singular form, not Elokechem. In other words, not I'm the God of the nation of plural, but to every individual yid, Hashem said, Anoichi Hashem.
Aren't we all just like one entity?
Well, I ate this breakfast this morning. You didn't have to eat, right?
Right, but essentially we're all like one. So if he says Alekecha.
No, he said Hashem Alekecha in order that it should be recognized by every individual. And it should not be said, okay, you know, he means the plural, he means the leaders, he means the scholars, he means the better people. He doesn't mean the better people. He means everybody. Every individual person.
Doesn't Hashem, isn't the greatest desire for Hashem that he fulfills are Torah and mitzvot, right? Torah and mitzvot, right? Like, that's what he wants us to do, right?
Mm-hmm.
So all we got to do is follow the Torah. Torah mitzvot, masim tovim, and something like that.
Okay.
So that's what he wants from us, just to be good people. Just to be good people.
There's no question.
No question.
I'm talking that you're right. You're absolutely right. That's what he wants from us. But I'm talking how we can counter the Yetzer Hara who comes and says, forget it. How do I come to it? I'm just a simple person. Where do I come, you know, to all the great things that the Torah says? This is the thing. And then I lazy out. Well, I don't have the encouragement. You know, okay, you'll do mitzvahs, you'll have a schus, you'll have special merit, and so on. I don't come to special merit. See, these are things that are constantly, we don't even want to admit it, but they're constantly attacking us. Because in the Yetzer Hara, the Nefesh HaBam comes back and start turning our attention to ourselves, who am I? And this is how we get discouraged. And it is important to understand that the who am I is not made by me, but made by Hashem. And all I have to do is nasa. I have to accept this declaration of Hashem that he made that we are his nation. And then I don't have to justify and argue my case with each other. What was the Mishkan made of? What are the things that Eden had to donate in order to build the Mishkan? It says Zohar, Kesef, and Choshes. So there's a Sikha from Rebbe, where the Rebbe explains the Zohar, the Kesef, and Choshes, these three things. I'm extracting a little piece of it. It's a broad Sikha. Rebbe explains Zohar, we all know Zohar is the most precious metal. Zohar is so precious, it actually defies, so to speak, the nature of the world. Because everything in the world spoils after a time. Everything in the world spoils. Including silver tarnishes. It loses some of it. It cannot stay fresh and shining indefinitely. Except for gold. What?
Depending on metal.
Right. And diamonds, it doesn't have that quality. And gold has an amazing nature. Mamish does not get affected by environment. You can soak gold for 1,000 years in water. You take it out, it's as clear as when you put it in. Which means it defies the limits of world. World, everything has to be limited. And this defies the limits of words. This is why the Medrash says, Loihoyo ho'eilom roi lihishtamish bezahav, that the world actually does not fit to use gold. Gold is an element that is higher than world, that doesn't have worldly limits, worldly qualities. And the gold was not created for world. Gold was created in the Beis Hamikdash. But because it is, and because it's for the Beis Hamikdash, that's why the world also was able to use it. But it is essentially created for the Beis Hamikdash, because it's in fact not a worldly, doesn't have a worldly quality to it. That's gold. Then there is silver. Silver is a precious metal, but it definitely does conform to the natural world. It does change, and it does not stay fresh and shiny just like, you know, without any effect. So the Rebbe says that gold, in fact, is something which is higher than world. Silver is the highest thing within the world. The highest thing within the confines of the world is silver. And then there is copper. Copper, of course, is completely, so to speak, within the nature, and it actually can spoil and can rot away and everything. So the Rebbe asks, since that in the Beis Hamikdash, we always use the best. Beis Hamikdash, we always use the best. And even build the Beis Hamikdash, if they can afford, they would use everything gold. That was the highest quality that's possible that you can afford. The Gemara says that when they had the Korban Tomid, drinking water, and Korban Tomid, they would give them to drink water, the sheep, to drink water before the Shechita. So the water that they present to the sheep to drink, they would present the water in a gold cup, a gold bucket. Why gold? For a behemoth to drink? The answer is that in the Hamikdash we do everything in the richest possible. The expression is Ein Aniyus B'Mokim Ashiyus. We don't recognize poverty in a place of plenty. And here, Hashem is telling Gideon to be in the Mishkan, and he says, Zohar, gold, Kesef L'Cheshes. Why Kesef L'Cheshes? Let everything be gold. And the answer is that the Beis Hamikdash is supposed to be, is built by Gideon, and it represents the entire Jewish people. And in the Jewish people, generally speaking, there are these three categories: gold, silver, and copper. And this is why the Beis Hamikdash also had to include gold, silver, and copper. And then the Rebbe goes on and explains what are these three categories: gold, silver, and copper.
The Indian speaks for clean gold.
What?
Mm-hmm.
That's right. Generally speaking, this. What's a gold, silver, and copper? Okay. So the Rebbe says like this: Tzadikim are silver. Silver is the highest madrega, the highest type of element that is within the worldly reach. A tzaddik is one who has reached the highest madrega that a person can reach within normal worldly process. That's a tzaddik. Gold is a baal teshuva. Baal Tshuva is called. how is a Baal Tshuva gold? Because what is a Baal Tshuva? What is the difference between a tzaddik and a Baal Tshuva? A tzaddik follows basically the normal fashion of life. You do everything right within the normal world. Baal Tshuva generally speaking means that he has to correct something. He has to correct something. If you have to correct something, you have to go higher than the world. How else are you going to correct it? I always give this illustration. And the person has a cut on his finger. And then he covers it over and it heals. How does it heal? Why does it heal? The finger is cut, right? So it's two separate pieces. Why does it heal? If you take this piece of paper and you cut it, can you possibly grow together? How does the finger grow? The answer is that in this finger there is a neshama. There's a soul. This soul is higher than the roof. And the soul was not affected by the cut. The cut was only in the goof, but there was no cut in the neshama. That wasn't affected. And therefore, the neshama forces the goof to grow back to the way it should be, because the neshama was never cut, never damaged. This is the principle of a Baal Tshuva. One second. A Baal Tshuva, for whatever reasons, and in our days it's all because of complete misguidance, nothing to do with themselves. But in fact, you know, they sapped in, they got exposed and all kinds of different things. So with all their exposure, with all their experience, there is always the neshama that was not involved, that was not affected, not infected by any of that. And they turn back to that which is completely above the goof, above the world. That's why the Baalei Tshuva are called gold, because they are actually reaching out to that which is beyond being affected by the natural world. Yes.
I don't know if it's relevant, and if you don't answer, but do you have an explanation for, like, if someone's limb gets cut off, does that mean there's a problem with their soul?
No. The soul is still whole. The soul is still whole.
So why doesn't the arm grow back?
No. It doesn't grow back. It can...
But Ramach Levarei the Nefesh Kereged Ramach Levarei Guf.
Yeah. But the Eivor of the Nefesh does not get damaged. It's still there.
Maybe the soul is damaged and that's why the arm...
No. Okay, that is off. And then there is copper. Copper is that element that actually gets affected and can actually be ruined. Copper applies the first to those who still need to make the tshuva. They didn't do tshuva yet, they still need to do tshuva. And all of these together form the Jewish people. And all of these together build the Beis HaMikdash. And Hashem dwells among the Jewish people in general and every individual lead in particular. How? Why? Well, they're just copper. What? What does this tell us? This tells us that Hashem dwells in the Jewish people not by virtue of how great they are themselves, but by virtue of who they are. That's exactly what we explained just now. Hashem, He made that choice. He made that declaration. And we only have to accept it. You only have to remember what we are in terms of what Hashem made us, and what type of koichos and capabilities Hashem gave us. Hashem gave us supernatural capabilities. Where do we see it? We take a piece of gold, silver, copper, we build a house, and Hashem comes in there. That's normal. That's not normal. That's entirely by Hashem's choice. We don't do it. We don't create that. That very same effect, that very same occurs when a po'ayid puts on tzitzis, puts on tefillin, keeps Shabbos and davens, exactly the same thing. He's davening and he says, I don't know what I'm doing. Hashem says, you don't know what you're doing, I know what you're doing. And that is what gives it its power. It's extremely important for us to reflect on this and to understand this is not a deep thing. On the other hand, this is extremely powerful, extremely easy thing to relate to. The reason it's an easy thing to relate to is because the fact is nobody has their own identity. Especially in today's world, there was nothing, there's no identity at all. Nobody knows anything. Who they are, what they are, there's no identity to anything. They're like, really like in Mitzrayim, where everyone lost their personal identity. And what we have is the identity that Hashem has given us. And that we have gratis. You know what gratis means? Free. Free of charge, was granted to us.
Be
Yerusha. Yeah. Be Yerusha, and then every individual is indirectly chosen by Yerusha. This is what we have. This is the koyches that we have. And he stands up and he davens and he says the words and says, but I don't know what I'm saying. So what value is it? Open the Shulchan Aruch and find out what the value of it is. And it happens. B'poyo mamish means an actual fact. What happens is, Hayid just simply follows, like you said, follows the Shulchan Aruch, does the Torah mitzvahs, only because he knows that he is a Yid, only because he knows that Hashem gave him this privilege and gave him this koiches to do. And somehow, without his understanding how it happens, Hashem helps and he grows and he is successful. He ultimately grows out, so to speak, to have his own place in the world and to build his own home. And everything somehow falls into place without him knowing how it happened. Because the power of our deeds is way beyond that who we are. The reason it's easier and the reason it's so powerful is that in when you say, okay, I'm putting on tefillin, I'm connecting to Hashem, I'm connecting to Hashem through some kind of a deed of mine. And then I ask, you know, how do I come to accomplish a thing like this? Whereas when we talk about the declaration that Hashem gave us, has nothing to do with me at all. It's not my accomplishment. It's not by virtue of what I do. This is what Hashem is asking me to accept. Accept what? Accept what He is doing for me. He is declaring me as His nation. All I have to do is say, okay, that's from Na'aseh v'Nishma. You don't have to, you know, this is the easiest thing how can you do that which you don't know what you're doing? This is your deed. You accept this declaration, and that's it. And from then on, the inner Torah mitzvah flows automatically.
It just seems like once a person gets to this state where he's putting on the feeling and he's connecting to Hashem and says, how do I come to accomplish this? But to me, that's already a level, once he's already thinking, how is it that I accomplish this? So he's already accepting the fact that it's being done. He already realized this is happening, but how is it possible that I have the power to do this? Seems at this point, he's already come to this recognition. He's already come to the recognition that I'm doing what Hashem wants me to do. I just don't understand how it is that I'm accomplishing it. But it seems like what's necessary is it seems like once you're already asking that question, you've already realized that Hashem has chosen you and this is why you're doing it. But how do you come to that to begin with?
The thing is, yes, right. If you realize this, you won't have these doubts bombard you. This is exactly what we're talking about. If you realize that you have this virtue just because Hashem is giving it to you, then you don't have these doubts. And yet these doubts are bombarding us. Where do I come to it? That is only because we fail to realize that this is not of our doing. Think about it, you see, there is, let us say, a very profound difference to that this is not of my doing. This is entirely in the fact that Hashem is the one who declared it, then a lot of the Yetzer Hara attacks just fall over the wayside. A lot of the doubts fall over the wayside. Yes, I don't understand. I don't know. Okay, so Na'aseh v'Nishma. So let me learn. And if I do understand, if I don't understand, it doesn't change who I am. You have the point that needs to be is recognized is that with this understanding, one can be inside Torah and Mitzvahs, inside, so to speak, inside the nation, inside the holiness, without as much as understanding what it's about. He's not an outsider. No Yid is an outsider, even in the copper. No Yid is an outsider because he is part of that nation that Hashem declared. And this is what we say, that every Yid, no matter where he is, at what level he is, we go out, this is where we see the principle of the Baal Shem Tov. We go out, the Rebbe had instructed us to go out and have a Yidin to put on film even once in a lifetime. What's the point? What does he have to do with it? He doesn't know what he's doing. The answer is, that's what he is. whether he knows it or not, it's not material. But if you come to him and say, look, you're Jewish, yes, put on film, and he puts on film as a Jew, he is right there accepting Hashem's declaration that he is a Jew. This is the greatest connection that it has. This is to the outside. On the inside, this carries us on a daily basis. This is what gets us up in the morning and says, Moida'ani. This is what gives us the encouragement and gives us the arsenal, the strength to overcome any kind of internal battles. There is a sikha from Rebbe, just as a final thing, I just want to mention to you. There was a sikha from Rebbe one time, and the Rebbe said like this. The Rebbe said that if a Yid should have a challenge, ask himself the question, how am I better than my neighbor, not the goy? Why do I have this privilege and he doesn't? He seems to be a decent guy. And why should I, on the other hand, why should I not live like he does? Enjoy and not just be involved in the world? So the Rebbe said, if a Yid would reflect, he would just remember that going back to our ancestry, where we come from, and you would go back and you would recognize that at the time when our grandfather was going around in the world teaching the world about God, his grandfather was, as the Rebbe expressed it, hanging from the tree and eating live human flesh. In other words, he was an animal relative to our father. So how do we compare? This is what's given to us. The fact that we got lost, the fact that Hashem, the Hashgocha brought this, Hashem saw to it that there should be all of these challenges that we're going through. This is all part of a grand plan. So that we should break through all of these challenges, break through all of these barriers, and we should become gold instead of silver. That's what it's all about. But it doesn't take anything away from us, Chas v'Shalom. On the contrary, it lifts us up to a category which is beyond the limits of the world. And each one of us here, and every Yid, in general, be successful, be blessed with Hatzlacha and Bracha. May we all see the Geula Shleima, the Kodesh.